Stai!
My name is Gabriel. I'm from Romania.
You know when you spoke earlier about the Romanians like squat with their knees in?
Yeah.
Is that something they coach a lot?
No. It's because what it's happened here, a lot of athletes or a lot of coaches, they try to learn to all the time to keep your knees in the sides. Mm-hmm. But this is happened more in the powerlifters.
Yes.
Because they stop above parallel and there it's easier to keep your knees in the sides. But when we do high bar squats and we need to reach below parallel, the femur is doing that internal rotation, and then it's like a mistake to try to keep your knees in the sides, because you will lose strength, you'll not have, your legs will not produce same strength. And this is a mistake to try to keep all the time your knees in the sides. And if you look at almost very good weightlifters that are competing in the Olympics or big competition, all they do when they are going up from the hole, the knees are going a bit in, because there is happened the internal rotation, and it's easiest way that our body, our legs, they are producing strength.
So when you're teaching people to squat, do they teach them knees come straight forward?
Yeah, knees follow the toes, and if your hips have enough mobility, it's not necessary to point your toes out. This is happen for athletes or for people that they have probably their hips are a bit stiff, and it's easier for them to squat with their toes pointed out. But it's not a mistake. Both options are good. You only need to find out what it's feeling better for you, for everyone.
Do you think it would be better if somebody is stiff to work on their mobility to get their toes pointed straight ahead? And take that for a few weeks maybe to get their toes pointed straight ahead, their knees coming forward, or to just point their toes out and start from there?
I think it's both options are okay. You can try both to see what is feeling best for you. And not necessary that someone has their toes pointed out. That mean we all need to do this one.
Yeah.
To practice both of them and to see what it's feeling much more comfortable for each individual. And if you feel better with toes a bit out, you can do them like that. If not, you can try different style.
You know, you said like over the last few days that variation, so people trying different things when they're learning.
Yeah.
Is there other things with the squat besides the feet that people should try? Should they try hand widths, their torso angles?
Yeah, this is also very important, and it's a part like a process to learn that in order to learn something you need to see more styles. Like if you are learned only one style and you keep doing that one, you don't feel how it's to do different. And that's why I think it's important to try all styles and to try to do more things, like change a bit your start position, jump more in the sides, change your grip, narrower, go a bit wider, see different, and to see more types of the technique, and you'll better understand what it's working best for you when you do the snatch or the clean. And here a lot of athletes, they learn a pattern and they stick with that one. They don't try, and they cannot change too much. It's not important. Necessary to keep that technique, because you can always change and work with lighter weights, and to feel also how it's different.
When you're working with lighter weights, how much lighter are they? 50%?
For me, when I was improving my technique and I was working a lot, I was like it to go up to finish my training, like to doing the sets up to 80%, 70% was for specific day, and after that I was all the time dropping down from the bar with like 10, 20, 30 kilograms, and working a bit extra, like 3-4 sets of technique. And then I was trying different to change, to see how it's feeling, if I change my grip, if I go wider, if I keep narrower, if I change my also my wrist to keep like that, I was trying what problem I was had at that moment and was not feeling well. I was trying more styles to see the difference and what is feeling best.
Did you keep going the whole way through until you were a senior athlete, or was it something mainly when you were younger?
This was happened more when I was younger, because also in that time I was growing a lot. And when you start weightlifting from a little age and you grow and your body grow, your bones, you become bigger, it's normally to be able to adapt that new technique, because you'll change all the time your start position, your and every time. For me was something normal, because I was changing almost every year, I think every 6 months, from 14 years up to 18. Like 4 years I was changing a lot my technique. I was doing a lot of forms, and after that I think when I was doing 18, 19 years, I was finding something that was going very, very well, and I was sticked with that one.
Have you, in your kind of senior career, made any changes? So if you, at 18 or 19, if you found something that worked, have you changed anything majorly in that whole time?
No, because I think this is the goal, to find something that is working for you, and to try to keep doing that thing that it's working very well. For example, when I was tracking my trainings and I was writing down what is going well and not, and I was looking, when I had a very good day, I was looking in the back what exercises I was doing, at what weights, what was the rest time, the days, how many days was passed. And after that I was trying to do same pattern, pass another 2-3 weeks, and to see if I can feel same or even better. And when you find the program that, or when you find some exercise that are feeling very good for you, it's good to remain at those one.
So for your back squat, Gabriel, what are the main things that makes it feel good for you?
What do you mean?
So is there like a certain amount of bracing? Is it your stance you focus on?
What I see at, especially at athletes that are at beginning, that they are trying to move too much the barbell. And when I do 70%, 60%, I try to keep the barbell as steady as possible, to not try to move it too much. And you see now they're doing like bouncing the barbell on their back, and I don't think it's helping a lot, this one. And it's better to try to keep the barbell very steady. And also, what I'm not doing, I'm not doing like to stay very tight with the barbell, because I see more that they give cues that you need to try to bend the barbell when you have on the back, to try to, I don't know, to squeeze your glutes, to, I don't do that. I'm like, when I'm standing before the squats, I'm like almost relaxed. Only my core is a bit braced, because you need to keep it. But like I don't try to bend the barbell with my arms. I don't try to, I don't know, to do weird stuff.
When you, just before you hit your heavy squats, is there anything in your mind? Are you thinking about a certain thing?
When I enter at the heavy squats?
Yeah.
No, I don't think something special. And depending also about the preparation, where I am in the preparation, because if I know that I have a very good in the back, a very good preparation, I have a confidence, very good confidence, and I know how much I can do. I'm like relaxed when I'm enter at some weights. But if I'm not in the very good shape and I'm trying to go higher, it's quite a bit different, because you need to see like in that moment how you feel, and to write like adapting after how it's going in that day.
With that, when you're not in good shape, so if somebody is watching this video and they say, I'm going to go for 20 kilo PR, 10 kilo PR, what advice would you give them? If they haven't squatted before, what advice would you give them?
If you are not in the good shape, I don't think it's a good to try max out at squats. I think it's better. You can easily find out based of your 3 RM max or 2 RM max where you are. Like you are 90%, if you can do 100 like 3 reps, you can know that you can do 1 rep, 110 or 115. No need to go to prove yourself that you really can do it. It's better to, if the preparation is not so good, and to be able to go after that to improve more, it's better to find out or to was your 1 RM based of your 3 RM.
Do you think weightlifters should ever test their 1 RM squat?
Depends of their back squats, because if you are like a top and you are very experienced, you don't need to try. For example, Lasha Talahatsi, I don't think it will help him more to do snatching clean and jerk to find his 1 RM at back squat. But for example, at a younger athlete that it's at beginning when he's building his confidence and improving his weights, I think it's good to try 1 RM at squats too.
How often do you think people should try?
I think at 6 weeks. 6 weeks you can try it, and if you have in the good mesocycle, you can try it 2-3 times.
Yes.
Yeah.
So one of the things you mentioned as well earlier is that people don't do enough volume, they don't do enough work with the squats, and yeah, they just keep going for heavier singles. How much volume do you think people should start off with?
Depends where you are in the preparation, but if you are in the, let's say you have a 4 weeks of training and you want to start a new cycle to do a squat or something, it's good at weightlifting. What we do is like between 5 and 8 reps, sometimes 10 reps, but depends also of everyone. But I think 6-8 reps, it's very good to start doing like 40%, 50%, 60%, even you can do like that, and to do like 3-4 sets. If you do more than this one, after that it will be harder to keep like 3-4 weeks to do a bit of volume. And that's why it's good to stick out a bit at fewer sets and to be able to maintain them like a month.
When the weightlifters are maxing their snatch, clean, and jerk,
yeah,
should they be in a place where they've done heavy squats recently? Should it be very close to their max? Should they be trying to hit new 1 RMs to line up a new snatch, clean, and jerk?
What I like to use here, it's a coefficient that you can use. For example, if you start the preparation and you want to simple to clean and jerk 100 kilograms, we use you need to multiply that 100 with 1.28, and it will give you 130. And these are like mathematic rules that you should be able first time to squat 130 if you want to be able to have enough strength to clean and jerk 100. So they can use this one. It's a very simple, because if you like, I want to clean and jerk 120 and my back squat it's like 110 or 120, it's very hard to be able to do it, to realize that 120 clean and jerk. But if your squat it's 150, 160, you have more chance. And we use all the time this coefficient. At the back squat it's 1.28. And at front squat it's 1.16.
Is there a similar coefficient for the snatch, or does the snatch not equate?
You can approximate how much you can snatch. If you calculate in 1 month, your glutathia medi, how it's calling, your medium weight at snatch, no, at back squats, deadlifts, and pulls. And you need to calculate that one, and it will give you a medium weight, and that medium weight should be your snatch.
Were these kind of numbers something on the national team, or when you were like a senior professional weightlifter, were these numbers things you would refer to very frequently, or was it more a kind of abstract concept?
Depends. I don't know. I think it's based on each coach, because if you like to keep tracking something, you can easily do them. But this one we had a lot when I was a junior, and we was training in the Bistrița, in the training place where we was 2 years ago. And in that time, that coach all the time, he was put us to write everything what that we do in the training, and he was calculate all the time the progress.
So you coach a lot of weightlifters at the moment. Do you like to use that system?
I was tried with some of the athletes that I have online to use that one, and I was given them some make in Google Sheets like a file where to enter all the time what was doing at the training, but it's not same because when you are a full athlete, this is your job, and you don't miss any training, and you can keep track much easier when you are training like because you like weightlifting, and you have also it's online coaching, it's coaching from start, probably the athletes, the people that they take coaching when they have a bad day or they are a bit tired, they don't do right everything like in the program, they miss 1, 2, 3 days, and after that it's very hard to track the training. Because with this, when you have 5 days and 3 are missed, and 2 are because you are tired, it's they don't work same.
Yeah.
And these one are more for full athletes, because this is your job. You don't have anything else to do. You only train, eat, and it's going.
Gabriel, if a amateur athlete comes to you, and they have a decent snatch and clean and jerk, but their back squat is very, very close to their best clean and jerk, do you ever put them in a strength phase where you focus more on strength, or would you keep working a snatch and clean and jerk and the squat?
No, because it's normal if they are very close that he probably has a strength issue, and it's better to focus on the strength to increase their squats and deadlift. And with that coefficient that we was speak a few minutes ago, with that one, also you can see easily, because if you are doing 100 clean and jerk and your squat it's more than 1.28, more than 130, and you do, for example, squats 150, you need to work more of your technique, because already you have the strength. But if your squats are 120, 110, it's obvious that you need to work on your strength. And I was meet some athletes that was like that. They was like at limit with the strength, and they need to improve their leg strength, and the technique will go up, the number will go up.
So Gabriel, if I could squat 230 and I can only clean and jerk 140 or 150, do you think I need to do a lot more clean and jerks?
Yeah, more technique, for
yeah.
Sure. You think you can squat now 230?
Maybe like 2 months ago?
Yeah. But it's important here also to, because there are some athletes that they have a big difference between back squat and front squat. And you can do like a medium between these two. And it will give you another number.
Okay.
And this is more close to the real. Because, for example, how much you was able to do front squat when you was doing 230 back squat?
200.
200, oh, it's pretty good. Front squat is solid too. Yeah, you need to improve the technique, for sure. Technique, probably your confidence, probably it will help to do more clean and jerk, more technique. Probably you was doing more squats than clean and jerk, than technique. And there it will be the gap, it will be higher
yeah.
all the time when you are focused too much on some exercise, and it's normal.
Just the last thing, when you were talking to Gerf about the strength phase, so if you have an athlete who needs to concentrate on strength, how long would you usually get an athlete? Do you just keep going until the number comes up, or do you say it's 4 weeks or 6 weeks?
I stay with the block between 2 and 6 weeks, and here is depending of how you feel. Because I ask all the time, how you feel, how was this week, was hard, it's feeling easy. You can see also on the video, on the movement, because the squats will become easier, the snatch will go also, it will see that the barbell is easier. And if it will, then when this happen, you can go forward, you can change. You can put maximal strength, you can increase the weights, do less reps, and see how it's going. But this, I think it's best to speak with the athlete or how you feel, because you cannot follow like we do these 2 weeks, these 4 weeks, and these 6 weeks, and you need to follow 100%, because it's not working like that. That's why like 2-6 weeks, depends. For example, hypertrophy, I don't plan too much with the athletes, like maximum 3 weeks. And after that, I change to the strength. And in the strength part, I'm staying like more time, because in this part, you work more between 60-80% at all, squats, snatch, deadlift, pulls, and you can easily improve your technique when you are between 60-80%. Because when you go above 80%, start to see the mistakes, probably the missed attempts, and that's why most of the time it's in the strength part.
Gabriel, if somebody wants to get coached by you or to get in contact, what's the best way for them to get on?
On my website, yeah.
And what's the website? We'll put a link below. But
GabrielSengrand.com, and they have there the online coaching option, and they can sign up, and after that they receive a form to complete, and after they complete that form, I will contact them. Yeah.
Perfect.
Thanks, Gabriel.
Thank you.